Hugh Riminton from 10 News First joins us now with a look at how Anzac Day has become such a big part of the fabric of the nation. Hugh, it's great to speak to you, as always. You recently took a trip through country New South Wales, and it's really opened your eyes to, I guess, the origins of Anzac Day there. Can you tell us
about it? Well, yeah, I came through this back road. It's just north of Gilgandra. It's about 5.5, 6 hours' drive out of Sydney. And there's this tiny little town called Torowina. And as you go out of the town, heading south, you come across this quite extraordinary statue. I'd never seen it, I'd never heard about this statue. I think everyone in Australia should reflect on it. It's a brilliant piece of work. It is the digger returning, dropping his rifle, the old Lee Enfield rifle, and then marching off with his hand on the plough. And there's a biblical kind of imagery to that. That's the Book of Isaiah says, you shall fashion from your swords, beat your swords into plowshares. It basically says, the war is over, you must now go to peace. And it reminded me so much of that brilliant Cold Chisel song, when the war is over, got to settle, got to start again. And that was the dilemma. And one of the brilliant things about that statue is that if you look at the eyes, I had a chat to the sculptor, Brett Garling, who comes from that area, and he said he didn't know how to make the face of the soldier. Did you make it optimistic because the future was coming, or do you have something that reflects on the experiences of the war that they just emerged from? And underneath that slouch hat, he went for what he calls the no man's land stare. So he's a young, lean man, and yet those eyes have seen the worst of everything. And it is such a brilliant piece of work. It's worth the journey to Torowina. But the other thing which is intriguing about it is that Torowina now is a tiny town. It has a population, I would say, in the dozens at most. But after the First World War, it was kind of the frontier, and it was a place where the diggers, when they returned, were allowed to put in for a ballot for free land. They were called soldier selections. And a lot of them were around that area. In fact, that whole landscape around Torowina were made up of these 5-acre blocks. And the tragedy of it was, is that they went back, they'd come through this appalling experience of the war, they went back to these 5-acre blocks, which they first had to clear. They couldn't make any living out of them. It would take a couple of years to clear it. And they'd have to borrow money or other sorts of things to stay alive while they cleared it. And when they'd cleared it, they had 5 acres. Right. And in a good year, you couldn't sustain yourself on 5 acres up in that country. And a lot of the times they weren't good years. And Brett Garling, the sculptor, who comes from an old family up that way, said they were called starvation blocks. People starved on them or they walked away from them. And it's a sort of a part of our history that we forget is the coming home for those diggers was tough. The war was tough, coming home was tough. And we know, in fact, that the death rate among diggers who survived the First World War in the first 10 years of coming back was astonishingly high. A lot of them drank themselves to death. A lot of them struggled in all sorts of other ways. So there is a real imperative to make sure that the coming home is as good as we can make it for our veterans.
Well, I guess there was no acknowledgement of mental health back then, was there? You know, they used to talk of shell shock, didn't they, when the diggers would wake up in the middle of the night screaming and they would say,
absolutely,
oh, that's just shell shocked, I'll get over
but,
it.
But, you know, shell shock was the name, we'd now call it PTSD, but it's absolutely real. The notion that it's some kind of new invention, which some people argued some years ago, is completely false. These people came back. In fact, Brett Garling had an uncle, the sculptor there, had an uncle who was a young man who fought as a tail gunner in Halifax bombers. And the average life expectancy was 8 missions. He made 39 missions. He said they used to drink before they would take off. And this is in World War II, he said they were often so drunk it was a struggle to get them into the planes. Wow. And he came back at 22 years old. He said, lovely bloke, broken man. He came back at 22 years old from the Second World War, a total alcoholic. And so those are the, you know, the consequences. War is a terrible thing.
Yeah.
It has terrible, terrible effects.
Yeah.
And we honour sacrifice not just for those pivotal moments of ludicrous courage, of going over the top against machine guns and all that sort of hideous insanity and, you know, strategic insanity and individual courage, but also we need to acknowledge just the grinding effects on on veterans who come home and what they see and what they go through.
Definitely. Hugh, what's the current state of the ADF at the moment? There's so much attention in the media, at least on the Ben Robert Smith case. Does that have any impact on our troops or our vets at the moment?
The Ben Robert Smith case, for those who haven't been paying close attention, he is suing newspapers and journalists for defamation over reports that he says falsely have claimed that he's a war criminal, as well as guilty of domestic violence and bullying of other troops. He says those are false. It has been going on now for months. What we do know is that this court case has to resolve itself, as it surely will in time. But what we do know is that the Brereton report, which was an investigation commissioned by the government, has come up with, I think it's 38 or 39 unlawful killings, that they are satisfied that there are good grounds to suspect that happened by Australian troops. There is a special investigator that is now looking into these to see if there are going to be criminal charges. Andrew Hastie, who is an assistant defence minister now, who was a captain in the SAS, says we cannot move on until these matters have been resolved. It is disturbing for veterans, particularly Afghanistan veterans. I think many feel as if their own service might be besmirched by the allegations against a few, and that would be desperately unfair. But at the same time, you know, I would certainly agree with Andrew Hastie, it can't be covered up. It must be dealt with fairly and squarely and justly, and we've got to get to the bottom of it so that we can go forward and so that veterans who've acted honourably, which unquestionably the overwhelming majority did, get to have that service honoured.
Yeah, most definitely. Well, what about the ADF's future then? How will our troops and our firepower be utilised going forward?
Well, one of the great difficulties for Australia right now, I'm going to editorialise a little bit because this would be my opinion from conversations with many people in the strategic space. Australia at the moment does not have a deterrent defence force. It has a defence force that's essentially been built up and planned to act as a kind of bolt-on, very professional bolt-on, to an American force, so that if at any time major conflict arises, and particularly anything that might threaten us, we would rely on our alliance with the United States to come to do essentially the heavy lifting with the massive military capacities that the United States has. The world is becoming a more and more difficult and more dangerous place, as we're seeing in Ukraine, as we may see in Taiwan, which is the great fear in our own time zone. And then beyond that, everyone sees the Solomon Islands, the prospects of a naval base. Make no mistake, there are very, despite what the Prime Minister said yesterday, there are very real prospects of that happening. And we need to get a more bang for buck deterrent defence force, or otherwise we run the risk of being caught in an embarrassing situation.
That we do, yeah. Much more from Hugh throughout the day on 10 News First. Hugh, thanks so much for
the update. Great to talk to you.
Brilliant.
Always is.